Thank you, Adobe and Ravensbourne, for having me. And as you heard, we're an incubation company here at Ravensbourne. We've been here for about 2 years. And as I say, I want to go from my talk about my story of when I graduated and the ups and downs and how that infers on my and how I run Masters of Pi here at Ravensbourne. So I normally put Neil Gaiman quotes in all my presentations because they're really good. And this one is particularly relevant to my career, and I would say is probably quite relevant to a lot of people's careers. This was during his commencement speech at the University of Arts, and he says, "Imagining a mountain, a distant mountain, my goal, I knew as long as I kept walking towards that mountain, I'd be all right." And what he was saying here was, in particular, because it was aimed at graduates, it was, if you do graduate and you don't get your dream job straight away, it doesn't matter, as long as that's still a goal. If you go off tangent, as long as you're going in the same direction, it doesn't matter, you'll be all right. And it's very true, and this is very applicable to me. So when I left university, I was bright-eyed and bushy-tailed. It was 2002, and I really did think I was going on an adventure, and I wanted to get into the games industry. As I was studying my illustration degree at Bournemouth, I got into gaming and the kind of whole gaming culture, and I just thought, well, this is what I really want to do. And I spent 2 years trying to get a job in games, and after 2 years, maybe over 100 plus job applications, phone calls, speaking to other 3D artists and stuff, I started to realize one thing, and that was that perhaps the market was oversaturated at this point. I'd spent 2 years trying to get a job. I was having problems with, this is 2004 now, so I was having problems with, I was entry level, I was going for, you know, salaries of 12K or even less, really low level salaries, but people with 3 years experience were going for these same jobs. And I wasn't the Picasso of game art at this point either. So I decided to make a tough decision. I was still living with my parents, working a part-time job, and I just wanted to get on with my life. So, my mountain was still there, it was my goal, but I decided to go off-piste slightly. So I decided to get into architecture visualization. So whereas it took me 2 years to get a job, not to get a job in games, it took me 2 weeks to get a job in architecture visualization because there was a lot more demand for 3D artists. But what I started to realize was, although it wasn't my dream job, I hadn't gone directly to my goal, I was learning things that perhaps I may not have learnt in the games industry. And in this instance, it was painting with light. As a 3D artist, if you're doing visualization, and this is the Commonwealth Games, I did this in 2006 for the Commonwealth Games this year, and we were basically tasked with taking, and this was a blank photograph template of the stadium. We had to fill it with light, fill it with people, make it feel real, make it feel like a real event. And that takes a lot of craftsmanship, a lot of understanding of painting with light, especially in 3D applications using 3ds Max and V-Ray and things like this. So although I wasn't making games, I was making these worlds and crafting them, and I was heading in the general direction of where I wanted to go. And then something interesting happened. After 2 years, I got fired all of a sudden. So I'd gone from spending a long time to get a job to finally getting a job to then losing my job again. And I was basically taken into a meeting room and said, "You got to leave. You're not good enough. You're fired." Basically, they just kicked me out, and they sent my items on my desk to me by mail. I wasn't even allowed back in the studio, and I hadn't breached any contracts, I hadn't broken any laws. It was basically just a lesson in how the creative industry works. Sometimes, it's quite a volatile, market out there. It's not a steady job, and this taught me that valuable lesson that job security is really an illusion in the creative industry. Markets contract and expand. Businesses that work within those markets also contract and expand. It's just the way it works. And so although this is a harsh lesson, it was a very useful lesson for me because it taught me that I had to really start to understand what I could contribute to the people who were employing me. I had to start thinking not just as an artist or a creative person, but also as a salesman, as a business person, of how do I present my skill sets. So at this time, I had a friend who was working in an interactive studio called Conchango, who's based in London, who are now called EMC, but at the time it was Conchango. And that was an interactive studio. I'd been playing around with some interactive technologies like XAML or WPF just for fun. But they did big, e-commerce websites and big prototyping projects with massive clients, huge brands. So I went along and I'd never made a website before and I'd never made any real interactive projects commercially. And I just blagged the hell out of it and I managed to get the job. So I went from doing visualization to a totally different role. I was seen as the 3D guy now. I was, instead of a 3D monkey just pumping out images, I was somebody who had a different skill set to everybody else in the team. And I was being brought in to kind of inject new thinking into projects, which was fantastic. It was exactly what I needed at the time. So here's an example of one of those projects. So this is back in early 2007, and this was for Tesco's, Tesco's R&D department. And this was the shopping of the future. So you would have this. This is before the word tablet even existed, but we had a touchscreen monitor in the kitchen. And you'd be basically going through your shopping list, and you'd be able to pick items like this. We had them in 3D. And you'd be able to spin them around and look at them. So it was exploring just how you could be shopping in the future. And so this was before the iPhone came out. And it was just a fantastic opportunity to kind of be in a room with the head of Tesco's marketing, head of Tesco's R&D, and having to, with a whiteboard, start to discuss ideas and strategies how to do this. So with Conchango, I learned user experience. I learned brand. I learned how to connect with audiences. Agile and lean principles, which are kind of managerial and strategic ways of deploying software. Again, would I have got these in the games industry at this point? Probably not. And now I use these on a daily basis, these skills, with Masters of Pi. And so just another quick project. This is a BMW as well that we did with Internet Explorer 9. And it's basically showcasing the browser and trying to get as high fidelity 3D as we could in the browser. So a wide range of projects, some prototype projects, some real commercial projects, and I really learned some valuable skills. So on the side, I was working in Conchango. I was making a name for myself, and the little graduate inside of me was still trying to get out. And he was 22-year-old me was saying, but Matt, you know, you left university, you wanted to get into games, you wanted to look at art direction, you wanted just to do all these kind of visually interesting things. So on the side, I was still illustrating, doing crazy illustrations. They weren't for commission, they were just for fun. I had an obsession with masks and, Paradise Lost, and I just really went crazy. And I kind of urge people who, you know, if you're not in your dream job yet, as a student or graduate, still keep doing the stuff that gets you up in the morning. Do it on the side, do it at the weekends if you can. Keep doing it, because creativity is a muscle. You need to keep flexing it, you need to keep working with it. And eventually you'll be able to bring this back in and infer it in your other work later on, which I will discuss in a moment. So, I decided to quit. I quit Conchango. I had fairly good salary and I was fairly comfortable, but I just felt, you know, I want to get to my mountain now. You know, I had a great time there and I learned a lot of stuff, but I needed to get back on track and move forward. So basically I quit and I started freelancing. And what freelancing started to teach me was some really interesting tools again, tools like sales tools, how to present myself. I was now having to sell myself as a commodity almost, or a bunch of skills to clients who are hiring me to obviously contract on these projects. So it taught me some interesting initial tertiary skills in sales, but also I really wanted to get into motion graphics and art direction at this point, because I really wanted to try and explore, especially with 3D, just how far could you push visuals. And motion graphics, you know, the motion graphics world at this point could really enable that. So I was using After Effects, Photoshop, Cinema 4D, all these kind of packages. But most importantly, I was working with some really interesting kind of companies in London. This one is with Territory, who will later I will talk about because the relationship changes slightly with Masters of Pi later on. But with Territory, I was working on some really big stuff. This one's Santander, and it's a really nice piece of kind of... It's both using this kind of graphic, holographic style, but also really high fidelity 3D, wrapping it up with like a film as well. So probably switch over to the video now.
Heard rumors and we've had debates, but if there's one, we think it might look like this.
And we've got not one, but two world champions to show you the fast way around.
An F1 driver's dream is to race at his home Grand Prix, but to race at your home Grand Prix in the city of London is something that you dream about. There have been many times when I've been driving around and thought, that would be an amazing corner. Imagine doing that corner 180 miles an hour. Before any race, you know, there's a lot of adrenaline pumping through your veins. It's a very tense moment, but it's also that feeling of excitement, knowing that you're going out there to drive a 750 horsepower Formula One car and you're going to try and tame it around the streets of London.
24 cars are lined up for the first time on the mile.
Rain in qualifying has put the McLarens on the second row.
Lewis will be looking for a good run into the first corner.
The lights are out, and away we go, and we're racing in London.
It's a short straight down to turn one. You're hitting the end of that straight, going into turn one at like 290 kilometers an hour, just here. And then into St. James, pretty quick chicane, third gear. You gotta run the curbs through there.
And up the hill to the Ritz, second gear corner. The important part is the exit because you've got a long straight afterwards.
Then it's flat out towards Hyde Park Corner.
It's pretty hilly through there. It does make it easy to tow up behind the car and hopefully dive down the inside.
Let's hope the Queen is watching this next section.
So we've got this point where the Palace is just over here. You're doing around 180. You're coming in on third, up to fourth, then back down to third.
Oh, huge slide on the exit.
My favourite straight would probably be just after the Palace. It's a birdcage walk, so it's just this part here. With the DRS, it's quite quick. Corner-wise would be down where Big Ben is. Just coming through Parliament and seeing this old historic circuit, I mean, it's pretty special.
The embankment becomes a marina for Grand Prix weekend.
There are many things we love about street circuits. The bumpiness, the tyre wear, the brake wear. Physically and mentally, it's so draining driving around a street circuit because everything seems to be happening so much faster. So it's a real rush. When you're leading that Grand Prix, the circuit just gets narrower and narrower every lap and makes it more and more difficult to concentrate.
Then you're braking hard, down from seventh for the left-hander at Santander and the final sector.
My favourite corner, it's Trafalgar. You can dive down the inside here before you go into the arch, which is possibly the scariest corner I've ever driven on.
When you're coming up to Admiralty Arch, it's kind of one lane, so one of them has to bail out. I guess the guy with the biggest balls will come out first.
And that's just one lap of the London Grand Prix by Santander. I'm Martin Brundle.
And I'm David Croft.
With Formula One world champions Lewis Hamilton and Jenson Button in London.
Santander. So that was a really cool project to work on. So Territory and We Are Inc. both together, they think they won an award for that. And I think it's safe to say it would be awesome to have F1 in London, actually, after watching that. But I worked exclusively on this kind of stuff, was the more holographic kind of visual design of this, working in the 3D. And working with Territory was fantastic because they have some very talented art directors there. And they've now gone on to do a lot of Hollywood stuff, which I will talk about later, as it infers on one of our other projects. But at the meantime, I'm still doing my illustration on the side. I'm still trying to experiment with visual styles. At this point, I went through a Cthulhu phase for about a year, I think, more Lovecraftian type of tales and stories. But also, I was experimenting, I was ditching the 2D stuff, working purely in 3D, looking at a low poly style. Now, for anyone in the room who does motion graphics or illustration, low poly, the faceted 3D, is now everywhere, and everyone's kind of been doing it, or it's been done to death now. But this was kind of rewinding to about 2010, 2011, and I was just kind of interested in it in terms of how you shape form using kind of really low fidelity 3D. It seems like a complete reversal from like VFX, but it really creates nice silhouettes and forms. Now, the co-founder of Master Pi, Carl Maddox, was also doing this kind of stuff as well and was also very interested in how we could use this low poly-ness to kind of create some interesting effects. So we decided to embark on our own short film. And at this point, Master Pi was just about formed. We didn't really know which direction it was going to go in, but we just decided to do what we knew, and that was 3D. We wanted to have a real strong visual art direction to it. And we were inspired with some really fantastic short films that were out at that point. Pivot, which is in the top right, and Between Bears down here. They're both on Vimeo, fantastic short films, using a very kind of low-poly aesthetic but done in really interesting ways. And also we kind of took inspiration from Zaha Hadid, which is on the left-hand side. He's an architect. There's beautiful illustrations showing like form of buildings, but also the movement of form. So we tried to kind of inject some of this into the actual short film we did. At this point in time, Olympic fever was beginning to bubble up in London. So we decided to do our own unofficial trailer of the Olympics using a low-poly style and using London, called The Olympians, which I'll show you now. Thank you very much. So that was The Olympians, and it was really well received. It was made pretty much by two of us, me and Carl, 95% of it. It took about 9 months of blood, sweat and tears, but it was really enjoyable. And also, interestingly enough, the score and the sound effects that you heard there were done by a student here at Ravensbourne, and it was a student called Ben Brannan, and at the time, he was a second year as well. And it was the first time we'd actually worked with a student with Masters of Pi. And he did a staggeringly good job. We, at the beginning, when we were just fleshing it out, he came on board and he did some kind of initial compositions and stuff, an initial score. But then when we started to get some money back into the company through other projects, which I'll talk about in a moment, we then hired him on to do a whole score. But he did that in a week. and all the sound effects, which is just, it was crazy. So he's a crazy talented guy. And so, yeah, it was really well received. We got staff picked on Vimeo, which is a massive boost. And we won, you know, a bunch of film awards and featured in loads of different film festivals on TV and on those YouTube channels. We've had over probably roughly about 1 million plays, I'd say, which is just staggering. It's an amazing outcome, and all driven from the need to try and explore this kind of low poly style and what we can do with it. So I just as throwing the gauntlet down there for any students or, you know, graduates out there. It was two guys did this, and we're okay. We're not awesome 3D guys either. So basically, if you're thinking of doing a short film, then go for it. You can do it. So that was the Olympians. So let's see what the next one is. So carte blanche. So this is our first commercial project that we did, and it was a game. I'd finally got to my mountain. I was finally making a living making games. I mean, it wasn't exactly Doom 4 or World of Warcraft 2, but I mean, it was getting commissioned to make games, and we were doing it for kids. And we were having to kind of start to learn, you know, game mechanics, how do your users, what's the mechanics of fun. But something interesting started to happen. We'd, you know, gone from the Olympians, we were interested in very high fidelity, you know, kind of 3D visuals, which we were taking into all our projects. But we started to integrate technology. So here is a toy that actually communicates with the iPad, or the iPad, kind of, they talk to each other. So when you do certain things and unlock certain parts of the game, the toy would actually respond, sit down, it'd bark, it would kind of do all these kind of things. And it was a whole thing of physical and digital that we hadn't really thought about. We'd been purely in digital. So this started to kind of shape some of the thinking and kind of the projects that we started to go after with Masters of Pi. So the next one we did, which was really interesting, which was it's called Pro Train Taekwondo. And this was to teach people how to fly kick, do flying kicks, and do all sorts of Taekwondo stuff. And I think this was featured on Gadget Man a couple of weeks ago, or maybe a month ago. But basically, we took mocap from a Taekwondo grandmaster in the UK, and we put an XN suit on him, which you'll see in a moment, which is a whole bunch of like gyroscopes. So you don't need a mocap studio, you can do it in the Dojan, as is here. So you can take that kind of mocap data, and then you can apply it to your 3D models, and then you can put them into whatever environment you want. So, you know, whereas you have video you could shoot from four angles, with this you can see it from any angle. And we were trying to get the fidelity perfect, so it was exact from his techniques to the actual 3D model here. So this would be kind of an augmented learning experience. So whoever's practicing Taekwondo could, you know, go from the Dojan to their home, and they can continue their learning. But it was rich learning. They're getting, you know, the exact movements from a, you know, very high-ranking Taekwondo instructor. So really interesting. Again, mixing the physical and digital. We're taking mocap, we're taking physical data, and we're putting it into digital. It was just a general theme that we just kept working with Masters of Pi, I guess because there was a need out there to start putting these things together. So basically, we just came up with the tagline, technology made meaningful. And so we're kind of exploring all these different platforms, from Oculus Rift to Leap to Kinect, WebGL, all these kind of things. And so basically, Masters of Pi became not just about creating really high fidelity content, but also how does that work with the technology itself? So this project now, the next video I'm going to show, is something we released last week with the Oculus Rift, and it was for the Simmons, massive corporation, and it was set in a trade show in Hanover in Germany, and this is kind of the first time we're showing it publicly, really. And it was basically in a sales environment using the Oculus Rift, but it also, because we're not just going to do something boring, we wanted to also make Tony Stark style UI holographic effects inside of this. So if you could pop the video on. We'll be right back. probably just finish there. I'll probably start running out of time if I play the whole video. So that was a really interesting project because it's using the Oculus Rift, the DK2. There's not many projects, I don't think, like that out there at the moment. We were solving problems as we were going along, really, with this. And that's also something that we're starting to do a lot in MasterPy. And I'll talk about the processes of how we achieve that later. But visual style was still very important for us. It always is on all of our projects. So this is Mirror's Edge around the top left here and top right. I'm a massive fan of Mirror's Edge. It's still a fantastic game even today because they took a massive tangent in terms of visual style compared to all the other games at the time. Really clean kind of architectural forms and the use of color as well to highlight was just absolute genius. So we took some of the inspiration of that. This is an actual factory that Simmons have where they build the massive turbines for the wind turbines. So the Simmons even had their factories kind of looking in this style of which we wanted to do. So we kind of just applied that into the virtual world. Obviously, we're starting to use gaming technology, and virtual reality is incredibly intensive on GPUs at the moment. But we just wanted to create a space that people would want to sit in. I don't know if anybody's tried a DK2 on Oculus Rift, but you really do feel like you're inside the world. They call it a sense of presence, where you forget you're on Earth and you're in the new digital world. So we wanted to create an environment that was quite pleasing to the eye and aesthetic. We wanted to kind of approach it as if Apple would design a factory. What would it look like? It would probably be very clean, lots of whites, lots of bright, bloomy colors and things like this. But this wasn't the main selling point. This is just to show their products physically. A lot of Simmons products, and this is in the engineering world, they deal with a lot of things that are invisible, things like data, things like artificial intelligence. They have AI systems which regulate lots of things. They also have electricity and the flow of electricity and backwards and forwards. So how do you kind of showcase these things, these invisible things, in an interesting way that can educate their customers but also be aesthetic and interesting at the same time? So this is where Territory came in again. So Territory were my clients when I was freelancing. The roles were reversed for this project because we were still talking and, you know, chatting and sharing our projects that we'd been doing. And Territory had been doing a lot of work in Hollywood, basically. They've been doing all the fantasy UI for, this is Guardians of the Galaxy, and I think they did Prometheus as well. So they've been doing some really big stuff. And we kind of really wanted to do something interesting with the kind of the way the UI works in VR, because it works very differently than in 2D, because it is literally like you're holding up sign, you know, they're floating around you, just like Tony Stark has when he has his big holographic kind of room. So we wanted to get the guys who've been building this stuff before it even existed to kind of work with us. Because they've been trying to solve these problems. Even though they're in a fictional world, they're still going to have to try and make this stuff look real and feel real to an audience. So they've been trying to solve some of the kind of visual problems already. So we try to take that knowledge and kind of inject it into the project. So Territory kind of came out with these fantastic visuals, which came like a guide, you know, like an art direction template, really, for us. Because we had to take all the stuff, you know, this is done in Photoshop, Cinema 4D Illustrator. So we had to take that and then start to put that into the VR. But it was a really good starting point for us in terms of giving us kind of something to aim for. And so here's some more examples. So this is kind of like the AI system, which calculates loads of different crazy computations and calculations. I mean, how do you show an AI entity? You know, we really wanted to make it feel like it was an intelligence that was in there. So we were using these kind of really nice graphic design styled kind of approaches to show some of these really complex kind of products that they needed to sell on the day. And then, so this is kind of like what they call the HMI that comes up in front of you and is kind of your interface into the VR world. So you'd make your changes on this, it would then appear, and the actual VR world would change and respond to the kind of inputs that you'd been putting into it. But it all still had to look really nice. We still wanted it to feel really, really slick. So porting it into the VR, you have to make a few concessions working in a game engine, but we really did try to push it as hard as we could. So a lot of this stuff, it's a bit difficult to see from a video it's really difficult to experience VR from just watching a video, but you can look at these objects and they heat up and they glow and stuff pops off. So it really feels like you're looking at a data-rich world that's responding to where you're looking at and where you're interacting with. And there's the HMI. It looks a little different because stuff's in 3D now, so things have to pop out and they float above each other on planes, so you can actually look around them like this in, because the Oculus Rift has a camera that tracks your head in 3D space. And all this stuff is really really interesting challenges, and there's no rule book out there on how to do this. It's a new frontier for us, which is kind of where we thrive as a company, is on the new frontier of technology and kind of what new challenges and kind of interesting things that it brings to the table. So as a company, we work kind of flat in terms of our structure. There's me and Carl in the middle as the directors, but we don't like to be the big boss men sitting on the top and just shouting commands down to our minions, basically. We like to create a nice flat structure so that everybody feels, you know, that like they're part of a whole team, that they've actually got something to contribute. So when we hire, basically the company is just me and Carl. We're just two people, but we hire in lots of contractors and we hire in students. So Simmons was the biggest project and the biggest number of students that we hired. With the S, obviously, is for the students. So we had two for 3D design. We had Joshua Griffin, who is a graduate and also a lecturer here. He lectures in Maya. He's a very highly skilled 3D modeler, and he was doing a lot of the 3D products and objects that you see in the factory and things like this. He was producing all that. We had Tom Phipps, who was a 3D motion graphics designer. He was a second year at the time here at Ravensbourne. He's now third year, and he did a fantastic job. Very interesting, his relationship because with us in terms of the way we worked, because we had Territory who were producing the art direction. Tom was taking that art direction and then synthesizing that into content and then using After Effects, creating how the animations would work. And then we were trying to use those animations as a guide in the VR. So Tom didn't have the massive weight on his shoulders of coming up with a whole visual style that had already been done for him, and he could use that as a guide, because we'd never give that to a student, all that massive responsibility. And likewise, it wouldn't be fair on a client who's paying to just have a student to be given all that responsibility. So it was a really nice kind of relationship that we had working through, you know, a student and Territory, a big studio who we were kind of working with. And obviously the sound design was Ben, who, you know, with the Olympians, we just hire him now all the time. He's now graduated and he's out there working with kind of broadcast companies as well, I think, in London. But we hire Ben in all the time. And he did a fantastic job once again on the project. So we also work quite differently with clients. We don't just get a brief sent in and then we disappear for 3 months and then come back and say, here it is. Because invariably the client will say, well, that's not what I asked for. We work in a system that I kind of mentioned and that I learnt in Conchango, which is agile. And we were working in lean, but lean didn't even exist in those days. But agile and lean essentially is rapid development and actually getting stuff out to your users. If you're working in software, it's really imperative to get user testing as early as possible. And so we worked in this way. We now work in this way all the time, but Simmons was kind of the first time I think we fully implemented it, because we had such a much larger team that we were working with. So this was delivering every two weeks. We would deliver a build to the client, and they had an Oculus Rift there in Germany, and they would be constantly testing it, and they'd be getting their engineers who were potential customers, and they would be using it, and they'd be telling us what was bad, what was good. So we went through 12 sprints. 3 months, and we basically over and over again, rapid deployment, rapid user feedback injected back into the system. What we also did was we brought the clients in as well here to Ravensbourne, and we sat down with them upstairs for 2 days. They worked with us, and that was fantastic as well. The clients absolutely loved it, and also the staff did as well. The students and the contractors that we had with us, they could actually feel like they were part of a team, and the client wasn't this faceless thing in the distance who was just paying everyone's wages. They were there and they could ask them direct questions, and the client loved it because there were faces put to the team, to the people who were building their product. So it created a really positive energy, I think. We got more done in those 2 days than we had done in a week, basically, because you know, the contractors and the students could ask direct questions to the client, which really boosted their confidence as well. And so we try to do that. We try to create a safe environment for our students and for all of our staff. And by safe, I don't mean health and safety. I mean safe in is they can take risks. They can actually experiment. I never will tell anyone off for just, you know, trying something. We normally bake in enough time in our projects so that you can make changes. It's called iteration. Iteration is the key. You have to iterate all the time. That's how you make things better. You don't just sit in a bathtub and then go, wow, okay, I've got the idea. You have to just, you know, good ideas come from blood, sweat, and tears. It comes from working on an idea over and over again, almost like chiseling away, you know, at an anvil, so to speak. So we try and foster that environment in Masters of Pi. So I believe my next slide, yes. So basically, if I was to look for a student, if there's one thing, and there's a list of stuff that we look for in students, and I guess in all members of staff, but if it's the one thing that I really look for, it would be this, and that's stop worrying about what can go wrong and get excited about what can go right. It's easier said than done when you've got a client calling you like every hour or you've got a deadline the next day, and it's not really designed for that. This is why we work in the way we do with delivering every 2 weeks, because it enables us to stop worrying about going wrong, because we can just fix it in the next sprint. Obviously, we do have a finite amount of time and budget, but we're trying to foster an environment of experimentation, of solving problems. And you can only solve problems by working on them. You can't just come to them and suddenly solve them. And so for a student, I just want someone with an appetite for actually getting stuck in. And we did find that, you know, students get a little bit scared when they come into us because they're going, whoa, what the hell's going on? Because of the way we work. But eventually, it maybe take a week or so, they start to kind of open up, and it's really nice to see, because they start to come to me and say, hey, I tried this, you know, what do you think about it? So that's cool, we could take bits of this and put it over here. You know, because we're just trying to foster this environment of experimentation. And so, yes, that's what I would look for in a student. So just to wrap it up, if there's only one thing to take away from this, it would be if you are graduates, if you are students, if you're creative people, or if you're fostering students, I would say, you know, don't worry, okay? You don't have to go for your dream job, of course. You know, make that your goal, make it your mountain. But if you don't get there straight away, don't worry about it. I'm a testament to the fact that I took a long road round, and then by the time I got there, I realized all the stuff I'd learned, I could use it for lots of different things. So yeah, don't forget about your mountain. So there we go. Thank you very much.